that all right with everybody?
And try to keep ourselves.
Hi.
That's our official starting board. Hi, everybody. My name is Rick Barrett, and I'm pleased to welcome you here on behalf of the Temple University Collaborative on Community Inclusion of People with Psychiatric Disability. There are about a dozen or 18 of us here in the room. I'll say that to people who are joining us in a webinar format, and about 50 or 60 people joining us by webinar, which is why the technology is set up the way it is. And we're pleased to have all of you here, and obviously hope for a good deal of participation from those of you in the room, although the others will have to just listen in. We're going to be discussing today the expanding role of peer specialists in the delivery of community mental health services, and particularly the role of peer specialists in this expanding role in helping the people that they serve have more fulfilling and active, engaged lives in community settings, to address the issues of community inclusion that I'll be talking more about as we go along. We have 3 hours together till about noon. I'm a big talker, so it doesn't seem like very long for me. We have a lot of ground to cover. Our agenda roughly is, I'm going to spend a little bit of time, hopefully, till Jim nudges me and says stop, talking about what we mean by community inclusion, and talking about why we think it is important and very much the what we think of as the next generation of community mental health services, and the ways in which, in a very broad sense, we see peer specialists playing a crucial role in helping people to have more active, engaged, connected lives in community settings. I'm going to be joined by 3 people today. Krista Andrade, to my far right, is someone we were. Say hello, Krista.
Hello, everyone.
Krista has been our partner. She was working at the Mental Health Association of Southeastern Pennsylvania when we began working, and Mental Health Association of Southeastern Pennsylvania is one of our partners in the operation of the Temple Collaborative. And she was our partner in looking at the issue of how can we help people who were interested in joining congregations of their choice, not only to attend services, but also to be involved in all of the fellowship activities of congregations, and to feel more connected and engaged and included in that kind of activity. And she's going to be talking about that. Jim Klassen, to my immediate right, is part of MHASD's Institute on Recovery and Community Inclusion, with a major emphasis on training of peer specialists. And with us, participated in the development of a 2-day training curriculum around competitive employment. What is the role that peer specialists can play in helping the people they serve think about, return to, and be successful at competitive employment? And later on, around 11 o'clock, we'll be joined by Skype by David Measle, who's out at the Pennsylvania Peer Support Coalition. Can't join us in person because at this very moment he's doing the training, but it's going to take a break at 11 o'clock and talk to us about that training. We work with David and the Pennsylvania Peer Support Coalition around the development of another 2 or 3 day advanced training program that helped peer specialists prepare for roles in crisis intervention services, so that they're better prepared to understand their role if they're operating a hotline, if they're part of a crisis intervention mobile team going out and making visits, if they're working in a crisis residential program. And that's the way our agenda will go. Hopefully, at the end of the morning, we'll have some time to talk about a variety of things, both what you see as other roles that peer specialists can play in promoting community inclusion, and also what we can do here at the Temple Collaborative with our partners in helping you to generate some of this activity and training within your own settings, because we very much want to use this as a springboard to be more active with people in developing local programs. Is that what you think you signed up for?
Yes.
All right. Just want to make sure nobody is here for a lecture on rock stars and their emotional problems. You're all clear. Okay. For those of us who are here, maybe we can go around quickly, just have you say hello, what your name is, what agency you're from, and what your job is there, but quickly, because in this kind of group, it could take all afternoon and morning, and hope that the mix of peer specialists and supervisors and others is reflected in the people who have joined us online as well. Eve, do you want to start?
Sure. My name is Eve Hauser. I am a certified peer specialist. A number of other trainings I've done, including Coke with Tim in the past. I am a peer recovery navigator from Magellan Bay and Girl Health in Bucks County.
Great.
And my role is to enhance and support the support of the county.
Great.
Hi, everybody. Call me Barry. I'm from Hong Kong. I'm working in
Great. And we'd be particularly interested in doing training and consultation over in Hong Kong.
Hi, I'm Jack Klein, and I'm a certified peer specialist and I work at Catch.
Great.
Down in South Dallas.
Hi, I'm Sheila, and I'm from the Viking House. And I am also a peer specialist at Records of the State. I also do illness management recovery. I wear many hats at the Viking House because I have a great supervisor that teaches as well. I also go out to visit my people who are there, try to, have them navigate the system and trying to get out of the same that they have been for going so late. I wear a lot of hats. I drive company. I get people case management if necessary. If they have chronic other illnesses and need patient.
Great. Thanks for joining us. Pam?
I'm Pam Michelli. I am a clinical project manager at the Inspire Collaborative in Philadelphia Project. And I'm here because we're looking at how we can develop peer special care for patients as possible and promote communication for adults as possible.
Great. And a former staff member here at the Collaborative.
Yeah. I'm Mimi Wong, I'm a clinical coordinator at the Start
and
Support Project. Ma'am? I'm Erin, I'm an occupational therapy student, and I'm interested in creating programs to help disabilities become more included in
education. Great, and where are you an occupational therapy student?
Duke University, out of Pittsburgh, but I'm from the local area.
So okay. Thank you. Ma'am?
Hi, I'm Gloria. I am a certified peer specialist. I work at Comar program, and I support my peers to enhance and improve their lives from challenges that their illness tell them that they can't improve. Go out to the community, drive out to the job search, resumes. We go to time up with TV classes. We have to do one-on-one.
Good. Very nice. Thanks for joining us. Ma'am?
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Patricia Anguilla. I'm a vocational wellness educator, professional community health care, Sacramento.
Wow.
All right. Thanks for joining us.
I'm Anna Renee. I'm here. I returned to bed. It's a fun job. And I work here, but I'm
okay. Ma'am?
Hi, I'm Dana Sobelsaw. I'm from Florida. I was a manager of recovery and relief here, which is a special need Medicaid health plan. I've always been in general that was diagnosed with years of college. And so I supervise a team of specialists, and we've introduced the community participation measure, but kind of one of the more thoughtful that I'm sure I'm members of the
And we'll talk about the community participation measure later. I'm not sure everybody. Sir, you came in just as a almost.
Good morning. I'm Alan Bernstein from Florida. I work as the outreach and peer coordinator on the for the Lord's Place, which is the homeless agency.
Thank you. Sir, you came in late.
Good morning. My name's Adam, certified recovery specialist. I'm also the coordinator.
Great. So we have a mixture of peer specialists. We have a couple of supervisors, a peer specialist, and we have some program managers in other areas, and some people looking to expand the concept of peer specialists beyond the mental health field to serving other populations. Thank you all for coming. It's great for you to join us. The coffee and donuts have arrived. So as I line everybody is up, okay. So I'm going to keep going so we don't lose any time. But one or two at a time, go up and get yourself some coffee, and somebody really nice could get me some coffee if you're of a mind. If you think the session, black, please.
Oh, you're easy.
Yeah, the people say that about me all the time. Not really true. Okay, thank you all. A couple of ground rules before we get into the meeting. You're a kind man, Jay. Before we get into it, I am, as I've said, a big talker. Take the opportunity to raise your hand, interrupt me, add some information, argue with any of the three of us, share with us as we go through the morning how you see things. It's important, particularly that we have a large number of peer specialists here who are actively out in the field doing this work, so you can catch us if we're wandering a little bit and inaccurate in some of our assumptions. Each of you has received, and I think in the audience that's viewing us in the webinar should have received an email with a program, and the program includes a number of directions for you to link to some of the resources we're going to be talking about through the day, so that we want you to go to our website, which is tucollaborative.org, and look at some of the materials we'll be talking about, look at the other materials, and get back to us with any questions that you have and want to make sure. And again, to make the point that we are hopeful that we'll have the opportunity to be in touch with some of you or many of you, or all of you, after this webinar, to share. Well, now I've got two coffees.
There goes my tip.
Coffee? Sure. There you go. All right. Any other ground rules we should share? I'm the big talker, so if you talk for more than 2 minutes, I'm going to cut you off because it limits my time. All right. We okay?
Yes.
Okay. So let me begin. What I want to do in about 15 or 20 minutes is talk to you because I want to be real clear about what we mean by community inclusion and the role that we see that peer specialists can play that I hear that some of you are already playing. Let me begin by saying we're pleased to host you here at Temple University. Temple Collaborative on Community Inclusion for People with Psychiatric Disabilities is a federally funded project. It is a five-year research and training center. We are in our third five-year grant. from a federal agency called the National Institute on Disability, Independent Living, and Rehabilitation Research, with the ungainly name of Nidler, which sounds like a character from a Batman movie to me. And they have supported us in, really this is our 12th year now, of a wide range of activities, basically in two pockets. One pocket is research. We do a great deal of research. One, to find out how connected are people with serious mental health conditions in the community, how engaged are they, and what are the barriers, as well as research into what are the strategies that help people to be more engaged. And we'll talk a little bit about that as we go along. And our other agenda, of which this is part, is to provide a wide range of training and technical assistance and consultation services based on that research to help people look at their own programs, use some of the instruments we've developed, the community participation measure, to see how well integrated and active the people in your programs are, and what various staff members and various programs can do to help people to be connected. So we do on-site training, we do on-site consultation, we do a lot of distance training and technical assistance where we're on the phone, or and we've done a lot of these webinars. And if you go onto our website, you can hook into our newsletters and other activities, and also look at the resources. Well, that is a very generous grant from NIDIORR, and we draw down other federal and state grants to support a great deal of the work, particularly the work we'll be talking about today. So what is it exactly that we mean when we say we're studying and doing training around community inclusion? There are a couple of definitions that I'll share with you. The first is our boss, Mark Salzer, Dr. Mark Salzer here at Temple, who's the chair of the Department of Rehabilitation Sciences, of which we are a part. And Mark's definition, which is now increasingly cited in the literature, is that it's the opportunity for individuals with mental health conditions to participate in their communities of choice, just like everybody else. And there are two aspects, three aspects of that. It's an opportunity. So what we try to do is help people create those opportunities to participate, to be actively engaged in, and to do it like everybody else. And sometimes we have a tendency, as you know, to organize a trip of 15 or 20 people to go to the ballpark from a community mental health center or a psychiatric rehabilitation program. That's not like everybody else. What we're trying to do is to get people actively engaged in their community, just the way everybody else does, to participate like everybody else. I use the definition sometimes when Mark is in here to talk about, I guess, what I call challenging the overly warm embrace of the mental health system, if you know what I mean. We have a tendency with the best of intentions to provide for people, to provide residential programs, to provide in-house workshops, to organize social events, to bring in people to run religious services or study groups. And we hold people with us, perhaps longer than people really want to be held with us or need to be held with us. And what we're arguing for in this definition of community inclusion is to take some of the resources that we expend in planning programs for people within the mental health framework and begin working with people individually to connect them more effectively on their own or in small groups with the things that go on within the community setting. To get people into competitive jobs, to help people establish themselves in residences, to join a congregation that they're particularly interested in, to develop a social life, to think about intimacy and sexual activity the way everybody else does in the community, and to do so outside of what a sociologist named Susan Estroff called the subculture of psychiatric disability. Does that ring true with people here? Yeah. Good. And there's a third definition, which is because recovery has been played such an important role in transforming the mental health system, to talk about what is the connection between recovery and community inclusion. And if recovery is about such absolutely critical issues as hope and empowerment and having a sense of a future, we see those not as ends in and of themselves, but as instruments toward community inclusion. We see community inclusion as what recovery is for. It's good to have hope, but then you want to have hope to do something and then to be helped to do it. It's good to have empowerment, to be empowered, and you want to use that empowerment to say, this is the aspect of community life that I want to be engaged in. I want to reconnect with my family. I want to join a gym. I want to walk regularly in the park with a group of walkers. I want to be part of the community. I'm going to make that decision, and I need your help in making that happen. So that we're talking about this range of programs that help people decide what it is they want to do with their lives and to get the help and support they need in order to do that. I'm sorry, Miss, you joined us after we did introductions. Just say hello.
Hi.
And your name?
I'm Renee.
Hi, Renee. Thanks for joining us. Is that fairly clear? Anybody want to pick a fight with me yet? All right. Yes, go ahead. Yes.
Because without that support, you know, things get a little scary for them, and they end up coming back to the program.
Exactly right. Exactly right. We are not talking about abandoning people to the community. We are talking about helping people and providing the supports they need and having the time and the resources within our mental health system to help people be actively engaged because this is a serious illness. Some people have recovered, but that doesn't mean they don't still struggle with the issues, particularly the issues surrounding how they reconnect to community life. And why is that important? Why is that those supports important? I'll answer that. Yes, sir, you wanted to say something.
I want to agree with you, actually. And
I like you already.
Well, in the world of substance treatment and substance use recovery, there's also a very large subculture. I agree that transcending the subculture is really important. Yeah, that's to me the definition.
Get people back into their lives and or help them to redefine their lives. And what did it say one? Sir.
And I also agree with you, because I want to be on the good side.
A wise move. Yes.
In the world of oneself, where you have both mental illness and addiction at a very high level, and they're homeless, it makes it a very large subculture now.
Right.
And it's very important that they learn to get into that right line with the support system that is provided to the people.
Right. We know, for instance, that maybe 30 or 40% of people with mental illness live in residential programs in impoverished neighborhoods.
Yes, sir. I would say unemployment in general for people with skills about 70% unemployment.
70%?
85%.
85%. It is a staggering figure of unemployment. And it is a real marker of the way in which this population, from my perspective, for no particular reason, is isolated from the rest of society. Everybody else gets up and goes to work. These folks don't. And that's an enormous problem. Yes, sir.
Yes, I wanted
to... You know, I didn't really mean it when I said raise your hand and ask questions.
If that's the stuff I got to watch in terms of my relation, my peer relationship, how am I supporting you? What does that support look like? Am I supporting you to develop the natural support so that you can go on and do it, or am I trying to recreate some overly warm embrace and satisfying perhaps my, you know, my own needs. And I think that's the double-edged thing here, where peer support can be so really important about what we're talking about, because hopefully we're the evidence, right? We're someone, I'm employed, and I've had serious emotional and mental challenges, and I'm doing it, and perhaps you can too. Not the way that I'm, maybe not even in the same, you know, kind of role or whatever, and that's, I'm sure we'll talk about that as well. But I'm glad that you brought that up, though.
Yeah. Right. And it's one of the reasons that training peer specialists in community inclusion is so important, so that you can get at some of those issues.
I agree with you on what you said very early on, that, you know, we've almost done a disservice by embracing them and creating these environments. Know that if people don't thrive with that environment, it's very important. But we actually, in many cases, not all, a lot of people do need more hands-on support, but in many cases, we created that learned toughness.
Yes.
And people are very comfortable in the system that we've created of, here's what I need to do in order to get services and what I need,
yeah,
and not progress.
So I have a friend who has a long history of manic depression, and he'll pick me up in the car and we'll be going somewhere, and he'll say, give me directions wherever it is you're going. And I say, you know, last month, Mike, you drove your mother to Florida. You don't need my directions. But it is that notion that we foster, that you turn to somebody else for assistance. Sir?
Yeah. I think that the system helps people initially entitlement, and then it steps empowerment, and that's where the specialist and others, it has to register empowerment.
So one of the other pieces of data that we've looked at is social connections. You know, there's a lot of research about who's in your social network, and when studies have been done looking at a non-disabled population versus a disabled population, people say, well, I have about three people here, and about six people at the next level, and about eight people. It turns out that people with psychiatric disabilities report only about 50% of the number of people in their social networks that other people do, and half of that 50% turn out to be social workers and case managers and psychiatrists and peer specialists. It's a real measure of how contracted worlds become when you've had and been in treatment and care for a long time. We're finding the same thing. We were at a meeting, we did a survey with people in Montgomery County, which is outside of Philadelphia. People said, everybody went to church, which surprised me. When we looked closer, that's all they did. They went to church. They were unengaged, and Krista's going to be talking about this. They were unengaged in the life of the congregation. But they got up Sunday morning, put on good clothes, went to church, came home. Do people still put on good clothes to go to church? No. All right. I have to revise that in my notes. And there's just we've recently completed a survey with Mental Health America, which is one of our other partners in the operation of the collaborative, and they've asked family caregivers, parents and siblings of people with mental illness, about how well integrated are the people that you support, whether they live with you or elsewhere, in the broader community. And the woman at MHA, Debbie Plotnick, who is looking at the survey results, says it's absolutely heartbreaking. That people feel, the family members feel, I'm all this person has, and they don't know what to do about it. And it's odd, because every survey that looks at what do consumers say they want, it comes back with the same three kind of simple requests. I'd like a decent place to live, I'd like a good job, and I'd like a few friends. You would think we could deliver on that, but we haven't. And I just want to say just a bit about why I think we haven't. And it's a little simplistic, but it relates to a little takeaway of I think mental health professionals have by and large believed that people with psychiatric disabilities shouldn't, wouldn't, and couldn't participate more fully in community life. You will still hear case managers say, I don't think this person is ready for a job. If jobs are stressful, they won't be able to manage it, they'll get sick again. I don't think this person is ready to have a boyfriend. Social relationships and sexual relationships are very difficult for people to handle emotionally. They'll get sick and they'll wind up back in the hospital. I don't think this person is ready to volunteer or to join an exercise program outside of what we operate. We think they shouldn't. All the research in the area, and you can see it in one of the documents we're referring to you two is Well Together, which you can get online and reviews all of the research I'll be talking about, says what in fact happens is that people get better because they're involved in community activities, not that they get sick because of their involvement. Yes, ma'am.
So, and just for the purpose of the gay moment, in terms of community, to just break it down a little further, I think it, for me, it's more about culture. So there are cultural, social connections that people may have that their mama may not know about. So if you come from the street or if you've been homeless, you have connections. You have culture. Now, you may not have the same culture that other people may have. So I would just want to add that the definition of community may include subcultures,
right,
which could be whether their sexuality, their religion, their friends. Because we have friends outside of our parental.
Right, but we do know when we interview consumers. Well, we've developed an instrument called the Community Participation Measure, which is pretty straightforward, and it's administered to consumers, and we say, are you active in this area? Are you active enough in this area? Would you like to be more active in this area? And we break it down around social relationships and religion and grocery shopping, very basic things. And the data that comes back is alarming, that while what you say is true, that people do have some connections, an awful lot of people have very few connections.
Well, I just wanted to say that I understand your point of view, and I hear you. And what I'm adding is that if people are smoking marijuana, then they actually have a culture that may not make it to your data.
That's true. It may not be the healthiest.
The other addictive behaviors.
Right. May not be the healthiest.
I'm just trying to say, I understand what you're saying, but I'm talking about in the world I live in, and the poverty that I understand, that there are cultures that are not maybe that look so good on paper.
Can I ask you a question? Or is that the kind of culture you want to enter into your participants
No, I want people to be real. The truth of it is, of the vulnerable population, you're subjected to being mistreated by not just the cultures of the legitimate world, but also the subculture of the dark side. And so people do get into greater. So it's not what I want, it's what they want.
All right, one more, and I want to, two more, and I want to be able to move on. Go ahead, Rick.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Excellent point. I think, as I understand peer support, I'm here to learn because I'm not a peer support specialist, but I'm a peer. So, as I understand, the most important thing really is how to make community choices, because there are a lot of community choices out there.
Right.
And I'm really, if I understand the model, that's exactly what a peer support specialist is for.
Right. And help people figure out what it is they want to be.
Yeah, we talk about meeting people where they're at. We talk about holding the other in unconditional high regard, no matter what they're, you know.
Don't you help people make the types of choices that are going to
They should be in the driver's seat.
Yeah,
what do you want to do? And it may be one of the, I was interested because I'm assuming the folks that you asked were across the board were saying, I want a place to live. You know, I want to work or I want to be able to get some money somehow, right? Whatever that hustle looks like, whether, or, and to have friends. And I think what we're hearing is, don't assume that they don't have friends, or
right.
you know, or a network that you know that's there. Yeah.
I want to agree with people, but you know what? When you talk about integrating people, I do any change as well, and it's their choice. And the paperwork has changed so drastically. We have to ask them on the interchange, what do you identify yourself as? You understand, especially if you have a young adult that's having an identity crisis, or better yet, a man dressing as a woman. We have to give them choices, because that's what recovery is about.
So let me use that as a jumping off point for the second aspect, which is wooden. Because while we think there's still a lot of shouldn't, that people shouldn't be engaged in the community, there's also a perception often that people are unmotivated, and when asked, really don't make any choice.
Right.
That kind of learned helplessness that
right.
Eve was talking about. That people just say, oh, you know, I'm happy with this program, I'm happy with that program, and I don't think I should work, and I don't want to join the Y. And this perception that that motivation is somehow clinically a part of the problem, but also that people have sort of given up. And we always say, one, when you look at these surveys, people do say, well, if I had my druthers, I'd rather do this and that. Well, why don't they express it? They don't express it partially because we've been telling them not to, partially because we've been telling them they'll get sick, partially because they have tried in the past without support and have failed. They don't want to go back, partially because the parents tell them, I'm a little nervous about it. There's a whole variety of reasons that people say, I don't want to. And part of the job of the system, whoever it is to say, well, let's look at that a little bit more closely. Why don't you want to? And if you had your druthers and could structure it to accomplish what you want to accomplish, and start even in that intake interview. Because if people say, no, I don't want to work because they're afraid of Social Security.
If you're full of, not being here alone.
That's right.
Without the support. And I'll give you a prime example. I do integrate people to a Y, but the minute they become a member, I have to drop that and go do something else. And I tell my supervisor, you're not going to go to that. However, I'm the person that usually take these people to the Y, and when we have another cycle, another 14-week cycle of, other programs going on or other groups going on, they may put somebody else there, but I'm the person that's been going, and they're like, sure, I can't go exercise without you.
Right. And so one of the solutions we talked about for anyone doing this work, but particularly peer specialists, is at what point can you turn to the Y and say, is there somebody at the Y who will reach out for this individual and help them become more comfortable? Well, it's not really a liability, but there is this fearfulness about it. How do we create, one of part of the job is how do we create welcoming communities so that it isn't all on us?
As peer specialists and as we transform our members back into life, we build a healthy connection and relationship with trust.
Right.
And for them to, as a tendency of summer day, you're supposed to just put them out.
Right.
And then you got to move on.
Yes.
And they just feel like they dangle in a fear setting of what do I do next?
Yeah.
Instead of just like calling them, checking on them, hey, are you all right? What's going on? Right. That kind of stuff.
Exactly.
But we have to extend more to them so they can have the built confidence in their stuff.
Right.
So they can say, okay, I'm fine.
So sometimes it feels abrupt, right? Because of some rules or regulations that the person's met that goal and now you know. So how do we kind
of
step that down?
Even with the agencies like the Y,
mm-hmm.
they will not allow our folks with mental illness to exercise here without a staff member that can take that key and what you call it.
They can't do that. They cannot do that. So part of the task when we talk about community inclusion is to find gentle and loving ways to say the wise. You cannot do that. We have to find a better solution to this problem. But that's clearly discriminatory.
It is discriminatory, but what am I saying?
Well, that's part of what the training is about. How do you work with a community agency? I'll give you one quick example, then we'll go to you.
I don't want to talk about that. But, so I have open houses, and it's the way that we're interested in specific. So if someone were to say, no, why is having an open house? Let's all go.
Right.
And then if that's how they're interested, so they can become a member every turn, they were on their own in a way the first time. And well, that they can't discriminate. They really
but it's true. Thank you. It's clear that all kinds.
My point being is that when I take people to the Y, they had 12 weeks to become a member 12 times, and they pay $2 because we had partner on with the Y. So I go for that 12 weeks. If the person don't make that 12 week period, that means I have to fall off to the insurance agent and try to get the time extended. And I do that. But as soon as they drop, they become a full member, and I can't no longer go with them, they don't go. But on the other hand, the manager at the Y wants me there during that 12-week period just in case you permanently have some type of a mental episode. And that is discrimination. I see it all day, but I'm telling you what I'm going for.
So we've been talking about creating welcoming communities so that not only are we providing support, but we're looking for community organizations to acknowledge their responsibilities and to provide some support. Sometimes very well. I'll give you one good example. So we're out, as I said, in Montgomery County, talking to folks about the interests of a lot of people attending religious congregations. And I'm trying not to step on anybody's interest. This one guy is a member of the Mennonite Church, which is has an unusually strong social responsibility mission. And he says in their church, they began to notice there were three or four people from a variety of group homes in the county who had begun attending their churches and were disruptive. Shuffling around, needing to get up six times, get a cigarette break, mumbling to themselves, kind of inappropriate behavior, nothing I think most of us are all that familiar with. And the congregation was, I'm trying to find the right word, concerned. And they didn't know what to do with it. And they want to say the same thing, you know, and they take it to their young adult social responsibility committee. And they come up with this simple but brilliant solution. They get four volunteers from the Social Responsibility Committee. Each one calls one of these people and says, we've noticed you've joined the congregation. We're delighted to have you. On Sunday, why don't we meet a little bit before church? I can show you around. I can introduce you to people. I'd be happy to sit with you. If you need to get up for a cigarette break, I'll go with you. And the problem vanishes. People say, sure, that would be great. They feel comfortable, they get integrated, they meet other people, and the problem sort of drifts away. There was one woman who I talked to who said she ran a psychiatric rehabilitation program. They had a number of women, hate to seem sexist about this, who were interested in the knitting class. So she went to this local yarn shop where she knew the woman did knitting classes, and she said, would you come on Thursday afternoons and do a knitting class? And she said, no, I don't have the time for that. You must be out of your mind. But I do run a Thursday evening knitting class for other women in the community. Why don't you just have your four people come? And if I need some support, I'll phone you. So God love her. Talk to a woman who ran a secretarial training program. She was telling me the story, just a generic one. She was telling me the story. She had this one woman who had joined the class from as a training program from a community mental health center. And the instructor came to her and said, this woman is just disruptive. She goes on too long. She's coming. It's very disruptive. I want her out of the class. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to talk to her because she's very difficult. And so this woman calls the peer specialist or the case manager who made this placement into this program, and she says, what should I do? And the case manager wisely says, I think you should meet with her and tell her to cut it out. Just stop being disruptive. And they do that, and this woman goes, yeah, okay, I see the point. If we get community, if we are working individually with community agencies, we can get some support from them. It doesn't, I mean, I agree, that's a lot of what we need to be doing is providing the support, but also working with these community agencies. Because the perception is, I just want to go on so we don't lose track. I wish I had said don't talk rather than raise your hand.
You said.
But I didn't mean it, for God's sake. What else did you say? I'm serious about that. It's just something you say so you can appear to be affable and open. So, no, this is really an important discussion. Because the evidence is when we do that people couldn't, shouldn't, wouldn't, and couldn't. The evidence is that when we provide these supports, people succeed dramatically, far more than we think they're going to be able to succeed. And what we have to do is get all of our systems less focused on clinical issues and security and safety, and more focused on how do we support people in the community. I mentioned that Well Together document that really lays out a lot of these issues very nicely and recommend it to you. But it's going to apply whether we're talking about getting a job or going back to school, re-engaging with one's family, being involved in religion, sports, social life, intimacy issues. All of these are areas where people want to have fuller lives. And we think, this is the last point I'll make quickly, that peer specialists are in the ideal position to do this. I think some have taken this on. I think others have not. I think there's room for us to have peer specialists addressing this issue. Generically, when you're working with people and saying, what are you interested in? Really, really helping people to think about what parts of community life they would like to be active in. And then helping with them, serving as role models, as Jim was saying, helping to frame community inclusion goals, identifying what opportunities are out there in the community, helping people prepare for engaging in community life, working with community groups to provide support, accompanying people initially, but having a way to address those codependency issues so that you can pull out of that. Problem solving, things will come up over time where people need a little problem solving and highlighting these successes. We've been doing this in a variety of areas, looking at the roles of peer specialists, sometimes around training and the like. We did a national survey a few years ago of consumer-based programs, and I asked about what consumer-based programs were doing. And there's a wonderful report that you can get from our website called Into the Thick of Things about the way some innovative consumer-run programs are addressing these issues. We've explored the roles that peer specialists play in helping people with both mental health and criminal justice backgrounds re-enter the community and really have something other than the culture of illegal activities and illness to look forward to. Recently, we've been working with the Copeland Center and have done some webinars around the role of community inclusion for peer specialists, and are working toward a 3-day training program that we'll be offering next fall through the Copeland Center that focuses on this issue. Today, we have three partners who we've worked with in the past around particular domains of life where they've been working at the issue. Krista surveyed consumer-run programs about their engagement around helping people to join religious congregations of their choice, Again, if you look on your program, you'll see some of the resources on our website that you can draw down. But let me express my thanks to Krista for all the work she's done in this area and sort of turn it over to you.
Thank you. And thanks, everyone, for coming today. This is something I'm really excited about, the work I did with Temple. Some time ago, I started working with Temple as a co-chair of their National Leadership Committee. And that committee was put together of, yeah. What? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I thought you were like showing support for the National Leadership Committee. Anyway, it was a committee made up of peers, family members, and providers. And what we were meant to do was help the Temple Collaborative identify emerging areas of interest and things that they might want to look at, do research on, produce materials on. One of the things early on that we identified as being a really interesting topic and something very important to both the people with lived experience and the peer specialists who work with them is how to help people connect to the religious communities of their choice. So we started to think about this. We started to contact organizations across the country. We sent them a questionnaire. We talked to congregations that had programs to help people fully integrate into the community. We talked to the spiritual specialists who work on this. We talked to interdenominational organizations, you know, and peers themselves, peers who found themselves in their congregation feeling a little isolated, and they themselves began an outreach to find other people experiencing similar things. While many of the communities had really effective counseling programs, the churches and mosques and temples, what we were really interested in were programs that brought people into the main life of the congregation, more than just attending services, having leadership roles, leading Bible study, volunteering, becoming Eucharistic ministers, ushers. So another thing that we found really interesting as we talked to people, and especially to peers, was the idea of fellowship. I think as peer specialists, we know that natural supports are really important. And when someone already has a religious community or is interested in a religious community, this can become a real natural support for them. And it's not only the faith, it's the fellowship, it's the caring community of like-minded individuals and the supports that can result from that. Also, we know that research shows that, you know, spirituality and involvement in religious community is very helpful. Peer specialists are in a really unique position to help those they work with to assimilate into their communities. We were talking before about accompaniment, I don't remember her name, but she was talking about accompanying someone to the Y. And a lot of these congregations had this, the successful ones had this idea of accompaniment, standing side by side with someone, you know, not treating them or, condescending to them, but standing in fellowship with them. And a lot of the really successful congregations had programs like that. As a peer specialist, helping someone connect to their religious community, there's a few things you can do. First, obviously, identify with your organization your role. This is also one of the barriers. Talk to the organization you work with and identify what your role might be in connecting someone with their religious congregation. Once you've established that and you have someone who's already interested in attending services and becoming really involved in their congregation, you can identify concrete steps towards doing that. Maybe make a calendar of upcoming events. Maybe sit down and make a list of ways for them to participate more fully in the congregation. And again, accompaniment. Even if it's not a religious tradition that you subscribe to, you could accompany someone to not only services, but maybe, the coffee hour afterwards, Bible study. One of the parishes we talked to actually had, during coffee hour, a group of chairs in the back where parishioners were willing to talk to anyone who was experiencing depression, anxiety, various issues. And that was another way to naturally draw people into the congregation by maybe even forming friendships out of these interactions. There are a lot of barriers, and there are barriers to community integration with regards to religious organizations. There's barriers for peers, there's barriers for providers, there's barriers for the congregation itself. As far as for peers, there's anxiety, a natural anxiety about joining a new group or, not having many natural supports to begin with and going into an entirely new situation. People may be awareness of the stigma surrounding mental health conditions, so they might attend services, but they might feel really reluctant to share, beyond that. With the fact that they might be experiencing these issues. Also, there might be a lack of awareness of what's available to them in their community. As far as for congregations, lack of awareness, again, is an issue. Congregations might not be aware that there are people in their community who are facing this. So what often would happen is someone would be experiencing this. Either they, their family member, or even the clergy sometimes was the person who's experiencing mental health issues, would bring this to the awareness of the congregation and put it at the front of what they were doing. Other barriers for the congregations, lack of training, lack of awareness. They might not know all that much about mental health issues. And then for many clergy I spoke to, they're so busy. They have a whole congregation to attend to. They have so many different roles that they play. Very often, it makes sense for congregants or people with lived experience or family members or people who are concerned to take the initiative in starting something. Barriers for peer specialists, which I guess is something that specifically concerns us all here. Peers don't always know how to help. They don't always know if they should get involved in the spiritual life of the people they're working with. They may work for secular organizations or public organizations, and they may feel really, really reluctant about going into this with them because they may have received messages during their training that this is a domain you stay out of. You don't deal with someone's spirituality. And it's really a shame because it's a great natural support for so many people. They might also just want to avoid controversial topics like that, like spirituality. So we saw several things in common, congregations that were successful. The first, people sought to educate the congregation as a whole, first off. And people noticed that if you got the clergy on board, you got them to speak about it from the pulpit, that was really, really effective in getting people involved and getting people to understand this is an issue and it's not, something to be afraid of. It's a way to bring more people into the fold of your religion. The second thing most congregations did was make commitments, like a formal commitment. One organization had a congregational church in Boulder had a WISE covenant, and WISE stands for welcoming, inclusive, supportive, and engaged. And it was a commitment taken by everyone in the parish to reach out to people with psychiatric disabilities. They already had commitments about physical disabilities, LGBTQ issues, and things like that, and they just added this as a part of their mission. Then go about actively welcoming. You talked about side by side. A lot of these places had something called companioning, which was developed by a clergyman in Seattle who worked with homeless people and noticed that sitting side by side with someone rather than across from them and telling them this is what's available for you, but sitting like next to someone and saying, let's go do this together, is something that was really effective across the board. I don't know if I should stop for questions.
It's up to you. We gave you half an hour.
Okay. I might continue. Did you have something to say?
I
have more to say.
Oh, okay.
And a question. I'll start with a question. So have you been able to contact and work with at all the Gabriel Kaplan at Jewish Learning Venture?
I don't think so. I wrote this a couple years ago.
Right.
So. Really?
I serve on the inclusion community, and I just attended a great session that she ran that had leaders, lay leaders, and another one that was a little story, but this one was more technical than that, because it was focused on the Jewish high holidays.
Mm-hmm.
The question was, how can we create our congregation to be inclusive? And certainly this is everyone, GBLT, as well as people who have different types of disabilities. And I'm the voice of the English World Disability in my congregation, and they know that. I'm on a committee and that type of thing, and we've had a committee for about a year, but the congregation so far, but then obviously the churches are way ahead, and it's really good to get to them, but I wanted to say that little things that were certainly in the clergy that we discussed in this past session, the clergy can possibly talk about issue,
mm-hmm.
how can reach out and include, and especially, include, getting people to feel more involved in place of worship is what it's all about.
Right.
And so I just wanted to mention some words.
What is the name of the group?
The group is called Jewish Learning Ventures, and they are right up the road on the York Road.
Thanks for letting
me
know.
Or is it at Gratz or AI? Or
it's a building right next to Gratz.
Okay.
Oh, it's Tikva. Yeah.
They are wonderful. They're
great.
They're with Horizon now. And I take people on all of your socials, even on Sundays. I'm in a hayride. It was great. They are really wonderful because they invite us to everything. And for the most part, they have about 5 GPS. Nobody really want to go out on the weekend. But I feel some kind of way about that because if you're integrating into the community, you really want people to see different stuff and get an idea of what they can do outside of the community.
Yeah.
And do something. So for the most part, I'm a typical person, and they call me and they send me an email every month. They have wonderful free tips. They're free.
If you go on the Temple website, the Pew Collaborative website, rather, and read the document we put forth about welcoming faith communities, you mentioned Tikva, and there's a whole,
I know the Jewish community.
Talk to so many folks across the country, especially certified peer specialists like yourself,
right.
who find these like gems of organizations, and are able to refer many people to them. And sometimes even people who didn't have, religious beliefs to begin with. It's not something you put on someone, but they may discover it themselves. First, go ahead.
I was just curious whether the organization or any other, if you all have guidance on how
Yeah, so we put together a lot of resources in this Welcoming Faith Communities Guide. I don't know if anyone's familiar with Pathways to Promise. You are mental health ministries. There are some organizations that have really, really concrete steps on how to start ministries. There's the Caring Congregations model, which was started by mental health ministries. They have several steps. You educate the, you know, congregation. You make a commitment. You start services that really welcome people in. You offer support, including counseling, support groups, and then advocacy. You can go beyond just, you know, your own congregation offering support, but maybe get involved in letter writing campaigns and advocacy with your local representatives and stuff. I think you had a question.
One of the issues that's been touched upon that I remember Chris and I talked about a lot in the development of her publication is trying to distinguish for ourselves and then help congregations distinguish between this broad issue, which many congregations are interested in, of mental health education, which is really designed to help current parishioners of whatever religion feel more comfortable acknowledging that they may have some emotional problems and getting help. It's partially around the role of pastoral counseling for individual ministers and counselors, but also around recognizing that in a large congregation, you have lots of people who have some emotional problems. And then distinguishing separately, which is really what Crystal is focusing on, programs that say, well, in addition to our current parishioners, how do we welcome other people who are joining the congregation anew, who come to us with emotional problems? And make them feel welcome as well. And it's this distinction between this broad issue of mental health education, which a lot of congregations are interested in, and this additional step of reaching out and saying, how do we make people who are joining us for the first time maybe more comfortable in participating? This, sir, you had a...
Yeah, I'm thinking about my question again.
You can withdraw your question.
In the world of substance use recovery, of course, we're pretty much dominated by spiritual programs. And one of their mottos is spiritual recovery. So you talk a lot about organized religion. That's why I was revisiting the question, because I realized we're here to talk about community inclusion. Because that community can be seen as kind of self-culture. Some people will translate that into a religious community or organized religion. And some people still keep their spirituality very individualized, right? That's really the question.
I understand what you mean by that, though, because that's like an issue I thought of, and I think that we discussed as we were doing this work. I'm not sure what you're going to say, Rick, but I think we wanted to focus specifically on established religious traditions for this particular document, even though that's like a huge part of recovery and community integration, as well as a spirituality. Maybe that's more of an individualized thing, which is what you meant.
But it's what it, I mean, because you're touching on something that, you know, that for me, that it's like there's a kind of a paradox. There's sort of a similarity between recovery and spirituality, in that, you know, for a lot of us, there's sort of a shared experience, kind of know where you've been. And yet in the end, isn't recovery or spirituality become very personal and unique? It's like both things at the same time. It's interesting that you were looking at more established congregation. Yeah. So we're doing some work with Temple as well on this, and looking, you know, sort of beyond that, because there are other, you know, what about non-traditional ways and, you know, another group. So it's a fascinating.
But even topic. When we talk about other non-religious spiritual organizations, I think what we're talking about is less things that are centered in the mental health or addiction system, and those sorts of spiritual groups. I'm not much of a spiritual person, so my engagement in this has been a little weird. but those spiritually oriented groups that exist in the community that don't have mental health at their center, but some other common experiences, some other common need for spiritual expression, and helping people get into those groups in addition to whatever the treatment center.
I think I wanted to get to you because I think you kept raising your hand. And, no, yeah.
I think I got
it. Oh, no, it's okay. I just, I noticed that.
My member, what I call a member, where I work at, we engage them, a power, right, greater than their self, right, to center them, to make them feel more confident and believe in something that will take them to another level. So they choose to, like the young man said, this is the spiritual or not, the program, but it is their choice to which way if they want to, because some of them are, don't believe in a God or don't believe in this or that, so they just call it a power greater than itself.
Right. Right.
So some choose to use the NA, the AA, for a source of power. Some choose to go to a church called the Rock, Kensington Avenue, where they give back in the community, they welcome everybody in the community, and it's a really, really great organization at a church. They have a boxing ring there. Matter of fact, the movie Rocky,
right,
was just taken.
That's right.
There.
That's right.
So we are involved with them. But it's really, I'm just going to go back to the misformed information, the way people were raised.
Right.
So it's a fear of doing wrong that you might be punished in a certain way. Mm-hmm. So we have to redirect and give them the proper.
People might have already had negative experiences with other religious communities.
When I was a little girl. About 2 days ago. You know, we were taught if you do something wrong, you was going to be struck down by lightning and all that kind of stuff. So when you did stuff, you always thought you was going to be struck or something was going to happen to you, but it never happened. So that was just the fear or
right.
Misformed information that was planted in our minds. So we have to.
It's definitely an issue to talk to people about it.
And that becomes an issue both for the CPS themselves, right?
Right.
We'll look at that in the training because when you bring stuff up like that, yeah.
Empowered, it's not a destructive
right.
So that's the fear part that comes in. Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. I was taught this, it's got to redirect their mind, thoughts, and process to believe in something. So that's
right. But I do think in this area and other areas, we have to be sensitive to the issue of choice. That people get to say, no, I'm not interested in the spiritual. You ask me, I'm not interested in the spiritual life. So that people really get to choose whether they want a spiritual dimension of their life or they don't. And then if they do, how they want to express it. One of my unpleasant functions is to move us along. So if you have a few more points that you want to make, I want to move us along so we get all these topics covered. But clearly there's such a rich, this in addition to the other areas is so rich that we're going to have to find another way to discuss these in greater length. So go ahead, you make the last point.
Well, really, the documents that Temple has online are really, really helpful for peer specialists and others. There's a fact sheet for peers, there's a fact sheet for peer specialists. There's the document I wrote, there's some others. So I don't even know if I'm allowed to do this, but I could take email addresses and send it to you, or I could maybe get a link and provide a link and write it on the board or something so everyone can access these resources because they're great. And it also has an index of what?
That'll be easier on you.
Right. And there's an index, too, of, like, interdenominational resources, specific resources, peer specialist resources. So I'll write the link or something.
Wait, last comment in back.
I just wanted to ask, because I've
had
experience with really stellar places like your home, and I'm
talking about interface and feeling the barriers disappear. Mm-hmm. And healing happens, using inspiration and the health of the mentally exists as a thing, you know, mm-hmm. in those practices. But like this, I'm from Massachusetts, the big church, great chapel, they have life communities everywhere. Mm-hmm. And a friend, like someone I know kind of as a person in the community, so I'm not her first specialist or something, but she went to one of those life communities and she told me she thought she had heard from my other people come back. And it turned out it was real. Like, I didn't know if it was real or not, but it was real. And I tried to talk to them, and they just wanted to press her and help. Because she was seeing things or hearing things that they weren't, and they were uncomfortable years ago, whatever. And it's like, what are you doing? Because the church itself has an answer, but they're not following them.
Right,
like, I
not
know
following.
I don't know what it would do as peer specialist, but that was clearly taking a healing environment in her community. She was really in her older age. She was having she became a mental health provider, plain one. And then since we're not trying to kind of follow the process, there,
I don't want to oversimplify it and say this is easy. A lot of churches still have very negative attitudes. A lot of churches are unwilling to move forward, and we have to recognize that. And part of the task of the peer specialist is to help the individual you're working with figure out where they can go and what they can do and deal with some of the rejection that they will feel. But it doesn't mean we ought to turn away from the task of helping people find, if that's what they want. I just need to move us. Right. Believe me, so clearly this is an area where there's a lot of work to be done and a lot more discussion to be had, but I need to move us forward.
We could just email you according to this, because we have all the emails on the back of this. So
right.
If there's anything you take offense to or we want to tell you how great you did, we can email you and make it easier.
Only the latter part. Let me introduce Jim Klassen, who's been our partner in and his organization at the Mental Health Association. He's been our partner in looking at the area of competitive employment. I am a complete nut on the topic of competitive employment. This 85% unemployment rate drives me wild. There's really no excuse for it. But it is an area that peer specialists have not looked a lot at, I feel, and we got a grant from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration to sponsor the development of two training programs, one in person and one online. And we worked with the Mental Health Association, the Institute of Recovery and Community Inclusion, to develop the in-person training program for peer specialists to orient them around the issues of competitive employment and the role that they can play. And with that, Jim, you're on.
It's always great to work with Rick. I know when we first started looking at this issue of competitive, he looked at me and he said, "If I got to work, so do you." So that's basically his take on it. But Rick, and I hope you'll weigh in a little bit later, because I think in your actual field research, just uncovered, you know, very moving examples, as some of you are offering, right? Moving examples of things, both positive and painful, that happen out there that either translate to people not feeling included in the community and reluctant to go try that again, but also some great examples of people actually doing that. So I work for the Mental Health Association of Southeastern Pennsylvania. I work for a part of it. It's called the Institute for Recovery and Community Integration. So we kind of, you know, share that mission around not only recovery and people feeling well, feeling better, but community integration, community inclusion. We do a lot of training. All right. The centerpiece of our training is certified peer specialist training, 75-hour course in Pennsylvania. We're one of two providers that do that. We also train on Wellness Recovery Action Plan. Rick mentioned the Copeland Center before. That comes up again in our work around competitive employment, about how do people do, you know, a wrap for work, what kinds of supports can folks, do around that. We do a two-day training for certified peer specialist supervisors. So in Pennsylvania, if someone is or is going to be a supervisor over certified peer specialists, within 6 months of that happening, they're supposed to take that training with us, and that's a lot of fun to do that. In addition, there's continuing education opportunities. So Rick mentioned one. This is what I'm going to be talking about specifically: promoting competitive employment, a training program for peer specialists, a two-day training that's available in Pennsylvania and maybe other places as well. Don't know, but I'll give you some resources to know. What I really appreciated, and I only saw it this morning, was Rick's, that website, because there are more materials and links and references that I'm going to be able to, you know, give you verbally. But certainly want you to be in touch with us and to talk about when is this I'd like to see this happen. And if we have enough people to do it, we'll do it. We've done it in Harrisburg. We've done it in Philadelphia. Just, you know, by way of transitioning from what Krista was sharing about, we're also working on and almost finished with a one-day training, but we're calling it Bridging the Gap, supporting connections to spiritual communities. And so these are training opportunities that the Institute wants to make available locally and beyond locally to help support peer specialists support their peers, their members. Because what I'm always struck by is a lot of the stuff that we talk about affects me as well, right? How do I deal with some of the some of the issues that we're that we're talking about? So why do people work? Is there a common expectation that people work in our society for money? Self-esteem, passion, meaning and purpose in life,
a feeling of normalcy.
That's a common, it's kind of a universal and common expectation, at least in our society, maybe in all, that work or whatever name that has is really central to our identity. And I'm always reminded of Marge Piercy, the poet, Marge Piercy, to be of use, right? And this has always touched me in a way that, you know, to be on this planet, of what use am I, right? So the poem starts, Marge Piercy starts as, with the people I love best, jump into work head first, without dallying in the shadows, and swim off with sure strokes, almost out of sight. They seem to be natives of that element. So it seems to be, you know, part of the human experience to be of use, to work. We believe that, another one that maybe didn't come up here is this whole idea, and this is this inclusion piece, I guess, is the social network. Right? When I go to work, I'm part of another social network. If I go to a congregation, I'm part of another social network. If I go to a meeting, I'm part of a, right? So there's a lot of meaning and purpose and socialization, right? A lot of us spend more time at work than I do with my family, right? And they're, 40, maybe more hours a week. And the whole aspect of being social, I mean, what would make one less well than to be socially isolated, right? To be challenged with social deprivation, right? So I think a lot of that can happen, at work. And so as certified peer specialists, and this is kind of a, and I know Rick will correct me when I wade into this too deeply, because we are talking about competitive employment, right? We're talking about supporting people to work wherever they want to work. Right. So as certified peer specialists, some of us have made that choice. We're kind of working in the field, right? And have to be careful to not like over promote that. It's like that's the kind of work, that's the only kind of work that you can do, right? like that. But at the same time, we become, well, I guess I said this before, kind of we're the evidence,
right? So as someone that I'm disclosing my lived experience, right? My experiences with mental health challenges and related challenges. And yet here I am, you know, gainfully employed. So by virtue of that, offering some hope that maybe you'd like to work too. And again, I think Gloria, you know, so you keep emphasizing choice, and I think that's huge in any of these conversations, is that the peer's in the driver's seat, right? There's a menu of things that we might look at or whatever, but what it is that you want to do. So one of the things not the Institute, but the Temple worked with the Mental Health Association right out there in Delaware County is self-directed care, right? These are folks managing their own wellness, their own money around the way they spend, the way they spend their money, and to do things around community inclusion. Some of those goals that they might set are around work, and some of them may be around, some other issues as well. Ermi Mala, who was the program manager of that program, and Mark used to come out and visit quite often, and maybe Rick, you did too. She used to say that, you know, what is the role of a peer specialist? And she talked about it, first of all, being a role model of recovery ourselves, right? So if I'm not behaving and acting and talking a way that's consistent with those values and ethics, people are going to see that, and they're going to take from that. Self-care. I think there's occupational hazard in peer support work, and it goes back to what I mentioned before about the codependency thing, that I think that I'm here to fix you or something like that, and to really be in touch with. That ain't where it's at, right? You're in the driver's seat around that. But the two things I see with peer specialists are, one, not taking care of themselves, not being about, where's their support? Oh, comforter, where is your comfort, right? Is the way I word that. And the other is around professional boundaries, and ethics in their work. A lot of times, the best thing that we can do is just to listen. Just to listen, maybe not say anything. Usually people have the solution to, you know, what's ever vexing them that day themselves. But at the same time, what's important and very important, I think, in probably the two subjects that we've talked about so far and what David's going to talk about, is to be a resource broker, is to know and be up to date on what's available out there. Whether it be supported employment, whether it be offered care link programs like that, and I know that we're vocational specialists here, so I really do want to, hear what's the state of the art out in the field. So there's some of this within sort of our subculture of help around employment and places to make referrals and whatever, because there may be, as a CPS in my role, there's some restrictions as to what I can do or where I may be, overstepping in my role. And that is that's what the Office of Vocational Rehabilitation does or whatever. So kind of staying in my, in my lane around that. But being a resource broker, and that's not to say, that not to listen, but to be, up to date. And it sounds like you're really good at that. You know what's going on out there so that we can, help connect people to that. So some of the things that we deal with in that training are some of those resources. Another barriers, right, that come up. So what are some of the barriers that you see with folks that in this conversation about work? No. What do they say? Yeah, Eve?
I know one of the things we're talking about in my county is employment work groups that I belong to, the whole notion of what to disclose, if to disclose, when to disclose in a supportive employment environment.
Oh, Lordy.
Which is
huge. Yes.
Huge.
So self-disclosure, especially in the, so it's so weird. We get people applying to become a certified peer specialist. Of course, we want them to attest to the fact that they have lived experience or else, you're not eligible to be in the program. But, if you know, you're applying to Comcast or, you know, restaurant down the street, Wawa or down the street or whatever, it's probably not, a, you know, where you want to go with that, right?
Especially in terms of if you have a counselor, you know, if you do have a job.
How does that work? Yeah.
You know, still, does it mean that you tell everything, you know, you have a job coach?
Exactly.
You know, and there's very fine lines.
Very
what
good.
What to say, when
right.
to say it.
Yep, so disclosure. Yeah, Renee?
I think trust is really important because people around disabilities have houses and they, like, they usually probably control a lot of some people's right. relationships that have the person there. So, how do they rebuild trust that that's going to be productive? And also, not just getting off disability, but if they work,
right.
do they believe that they can do any other kind of work than what they've done?
Yes.
Can they have a vision mm-hmm. that trust?
Thank you. And you just, you touched on the one, a one big barrier that I did, you know, I was hoping to hear, because that's a biggie, right? Is I'm on SSI or SSDI. I can't work. Or somebody else is giving me misinformation about what will happen if I go to work. So what we stress is the importance of having a benefits counselor, right? Either in our state, either through a disability rights PA, or AHED, do they pronounce it AHEDD, AHED, right, can do benefits counseling. So there are work incentives for folks. So disclosure, trust, benefits, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Need guidance. They need a lot of guidance because I have had members who have had substantial career, bachelor's degree,
master's
degree,
whatever.
Very good.
You know, see,
and
yeah.
they have
yeah.
depressed
right. yeah.
the state that they're in, yeah. and yeah. then they want to go back to work.
Right.
But you got to guide them yeah. and not just push them.
It's amazing. It's amazing what you're pointing out. You know, what you're touching on, and this is Rick, this is the research, right, are these sort of myths. The people that have had a mental health challenge have never worked, don't
right.
have an education right. or whatever, and that ain't necessarily ain't necessarily so.
I did a survey a number of years ago. Did in-depth interviews with 60 people all over the country with a range, but some very people with very severe emotional problems in the past. Everybody had a work history.
Yeah.
There wasn't anybody who had never worked. People are very familiar with that. They struggle, but everybody has a work, almost everybody.
Yeah, Dana.
Having a living wage, if you're coming off of disability care, but right now, it's
huge.
Going to go away at once.
But it doesn't go
yeah.
away at once.
No,
that's the myth.
But I did that wrong. So I can tell you that it's you like it's going all away at once.
It may, right. But it, properly managed, there's no reason for that sort of. I've got a million benefits and I have no benefits to have.
I got you. From experience, it's very
over. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And I think that's where the support, the guidance, you know, comes in, and having a benefits counselor because, you know, now he's next to me, so he may swap me here. But I have seen this because people are very, very smart.
Yeah.
Right? There's no lack of brain survival.
Yeah.
People be surviving, and they've constructed what they've got. So you knock one of those little cards out of there, and then housing, other things, you know, start to happen. But I think, you know, with guidance and doing it thoughtfully, it, you know, it's doable. Yeah.
Also, first of all, I like to say that when we have a person and we're training them to do the job thing, we also take them to trainings at VH10, where they can get the experience. And then after that, we do mock interviews with them, because some people don't know how to complete an interview or don't know what to say. And there's also OBR that will help them. Because I know 15 years ago, they helped me. And with that,
right.
you know, they don't pull the rug from under you until 5 years, okay?
Right.
5 years, and you work 40 hours,
right.
and you're done. You know, they're like, okay, you're
yep.
good, you're doing well.
Right.
But actually, if they already have that in the Social Security office. They have your records. You can still continue to go back and get that Social Security that you need. But they have a lot of support and guidance. Like the gentleman said, it can't be done.
I'd also want to make the point that when we talk about competitive employment, we talk about real jobs. We can also talk about a variety of real jobs, not only a variety of different job types, but you know, a lot of Americans work part-time. A lot of Americans work one job for 3 months and then they shift to another job for 6 months. We have to have a sort of normalized model. We're not talking about employment as a binary. You're either unemployed or you're working full-time and self-supporting.
Right.
That's not the way it works out in the rest of the world. Lots of people work part-time or go back to work on a gradual basis.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what we're suggesting some people ought to be considering as well.
Right.
It's not no work or all work. It's what's your individual path back to competitive employment.
Mm-hmm. Rick?
Okay.
Or Rich? Is it Rich?
It's Rich.
Rich, I'm sorry.
Sure. Jim, thank you so much. It's great information. I just want to mention my background is with the facility here years gone by, and I was a special board of Montana County as a consultant. You're coaching, I developed new things because I think the system is a system. And thank God for it. Because if we didn't have the system, it would be worse than it is. But the system's broken. And so I didn't say anything I want.
Now,
and Rick, I also came up with a new model.
And Rich, you're referring to the workforce system overall.
I'm talking about OER, I'm talking about Social Security, I'm talking about the whole thing. It's just not working as efficiently as it could.
Right.
It's understaffed, it's underfunded.
So, we probably come from a similar background. So it's just, you know, I've got about 10 minutes, so I want to hit a couple of other things.
If anybody wants information about this, I developed a simple way on how people can learn career planning.
Right.
And I'm very, very open to learning how this can be a system that more people can use. It's on my LinkedIn profile. It's out there. It's free right now.
Right.
There's other stuff that I do that's not, but I use an account management system to help people use the job. But it's not exactly a pitch while I'm here. I'm here to learn from you what you need, and then hopefully I think you forward to be part of the solution.
Right, but those resources exactly, what we're talking about. There's things that I can do as a CPS, but knowing those community resources and the workforce at large, CareerLink, One Stops, employment and training programs, education, right? There are many, many routes for this. So not staying stuck in, a sheltered workshop or, we're going to do some things over here at the clubhouse or whatever, but really kind of opening that up and thinking about other kinds of jobs and competitive employment with support. And with guidance and what Dana's, I think referring to, and I'm not sure, specifically there and Renee, folks that are on benefit, on SSI or SSDI, really having benefits counseling. And from that, you don't want to depend on me, right? I'm going to say, don't have me doing the math on this because, and that's the danger I see is that people get misinformation out there. So some of the other things.
I just got a question.
Yeah.
I'm not going to add.
Go ahead.
I want to know what you think. To get people to that point, what is your take on volunteering first? Because I have a saying, starting is half done. Everything in my life,
right,
the barrier is starting. And I believe that we hit on the peers are the ones who believe in people before they believe in themselves. And sometimes it's a matter of believing in yourself.
Right.
So what do you think about starting with volunteering?
Right.
And maybe they can fund it.
I'm gonna let Rick go first, and then I do have a take on this.
What was that?
We as a system default to the least demanding option again and again and again. I think volunteering is okay if you put a time limit on it and you're serious about that time. And I think volunteering in the area that you might want to pursue is okay if there's a time limit. And if it is clearly part of the plan to start and then move toward serious consideration over 3 months or 6 months, whatever it takes, toward competitive jobs. Our goal in this system is not to make people further dependent. It is to make them economically independent, if at all possible. And we have to be disciplined ourselves in saying, this volunteer role might be great, but this is not what we're working with you around as an end goal. Mm-hmm. And it's fine as a way to start, but if we're clear that it's only a start and then we're going to move to competitive employment, fine. If we're going to get lazy, as we do, and say, well, he's happy, he's got, 2 days a week, he's out doing that, that's good enough, and they give him a little bit of money and he's with people, fine. Meanwhile, all of that vocational potential that he or she may really have to function independently and earn a living is going to be lost. We have to be disciplined in what we offer people, or we will find ourselves in 20 years with just as many people unemployed as we have today. And that's 85%. I don't believe that makes any sense for us.
So,
do you like that answer?
I do. Starting is half done. You have more to go.
Right.
That's right.
Like getting through that barrier.
Right. So, and I agree with that. Although I've had so I was fortunate. I think I've worked now for 43 years. So I get through everything kind of backwards. And I got 2 minutes. So I'll just finish on a personal note, and then when we have Q&A or whatever later. Help. So I was fortunate. I was able to stay employed, but that's through self-disclosure, a couple of hospitalizations, a number of other. You know what I mean? So, I was in the employment and training business, right? Nonprofit, governmental. One of my best experiences, though, is with the AmeriCorps programs, with the National Service, with the expectation that people will serve. Will volunteer, sort of a domestic Peace Corps and things like that. So I was working, Rick. I was working and I was doing volunteer work at the Philadelphia Recovery Community Center, right?
PROAC,
right? Down at PROAC. That's what led me to my encore career as a certified peer specialist and a trainer. So who knows? Who knows? But it is all about choice. It's all about some of the tools that we have, about Wellness Recovery Action Plan or some of the ways to help support people. We just did a thing yesterday, in fact, on motivational interviewing, and we deal with it in this training. If you don't know I'm sure you probably all do, but motivational interviewing, that's the conversation about change and goals and what people want to make decisions about that I think is most, most powerful in our toolkit. And I'll shut up now. All right.
And I'll just make one more point, because we need to take a break and then figure out the technology to get our next speaker here by Skype or whatever it is we're doing that Paige is going to manage for. That's Paige, who did all the technical work.
Yay!
I'll make one last point. In working both with the Mental Health Association and with the other folks who developed the curriculum, around what are the skills that people need as peer specialists to be able to go back to work. One of the consistent arguments we've had, and that I think one of the issues they face in the training, is that peer specialists like to say to the people they're working with, you'd make a good peer specialist.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is one job. That is one type of job. There are 150,000 other jobs in the Dictionary of Occupational Titles from the Department of Labor. And people need to be, as peer specialists, open to the notion, hey, not everybody who's having a psychiatric disability makes a good peer specialist. Some people are just bastards, and they're never going to make a good peer specialist. Some people actually have a history in another field that they love, and they ought to be doing it. I'll tell this last story. I was out of the training program, and this young man was talking about his experience going back to work, and that he had been in this wonderful program, and they got him a job at Lowe's, and Lowe's put him in the gardening center, and he discovered that he loved gardening and he loved landscaping, and he was very happy in that job, and he had started taking a course on small business development so he could develop his own business as a landscaper and hire other people with disabilities. And you could see, and he was an African-American guy, and he had that sort of church-based ability to deliver, you know, be inspiring, and he was just that. And the first hand that went up was from the county office, and this woman said, how would you like to be a peer specialist? And I said, no! This guy has got another direction set for his life that maybe will set him free from the mental health system. Let's focus on what he wants to do with his life. And to be careful, and there are people who are going to make wonderful peer specialists, and we should grab them if that's what they want to do and that's the right choice. But we have to be clear as peer specialists that we're helping people figure out for themselves this wide range of jobs that can lie in front of them, some of which just to do maybe continuing to work in other aspects of the mental health system, but may also be outside of it. We're going to take a break, get some coffee and donuts. When we come back, we're going to be joined by Dave Measel, who's going to be talking about jobs for peer specialists within crisis intervention services. He's going to be on
staff. Yes.
He's
going
to be on staff. No, I don't think he takes all that kindly to that particular joke. All right, thank you all. It's been a great morning so far. And for the folks who are joining us, take a 10-minute break. We're going to start promptly at 11.
Yeah, and donuts are the kind of donuts that eat donuts.
All right.
It's a live thing. That's right. That's exactly right. Could have been a much larger.
What?
Could have been a much larger.
Company we're audit. People can basically speak very simple.
Are you able to hear me now?
Less than half an hour, but it's not time. And then they get a micro experience report and a development report that's past preferences and motivation leadership. But great keywords, and they learn about themselves. But the exciting thing is they get their own dashboard where they can see over 650 jobs that are ranked numerically according to how much they would love doing them. Here's the thing. 99% of people don't know what they want to be when they grow up. And Dr. Harris, that's right.
Oh, I got it. I got it. Email.
We connect on LinkedIn. Connect on LinkedIn. And Rich Davis, Comfort
Connection.
What do you do? What do you all
do? So, I'm working for Comcast right now. I used to work for the Clearing House, which is what partnered with a few Hello, this is Katie again, just wanting to check in with everyone who's here online and let you all know that we'll be getting started again shortly, just switching over to David Measel and the podcast thing.
Katie, are you
and my goal is to take the HR community, the organization for other specialists who work in corporations and help to staff and develop, and their community with tools like they have. And then
hey, Dave, so Paige just let me know that the people in the main workshop room will be able to hear you if you start speaking, and that they'd like you to, you know, just go ahead and go into your presentation because we're able to see it on our end of things.
Okay.
Oh, and we got them back at the same time, luckily enough.
How about that?
So, Dave, we're ready to go whenever you are.
Okay. First of all, I want to say hi to Rick. Rick was an integral part to creating this crisis training that I'm going to talk to. I also want to say hi to Jim. Jim was one of the trainers for when I attended my group rap facilitation training. So it was really nice to hear him speak a little bit earlier. I do apologize for not being there in person, but I'm in Montgomery County at Montgomery County Community College right now, actually running our new 3-day crisis training that I'm going to talk about. So first of all, let me introduce myself real quick. My name is Dave Measle. I am a certified peer specialist, certified peer specialist supervisor. I have taken the certified older adult peer support training as well. And as I mentioned, certified group rep facilitator. And currently I work as a contracted administrator for the Pennsylvania Peer Support Coalition. I'm going to talk about this newly developed training here in Pennsylvania to train certified peer specialists to work in crisis services. So let me give you a little bit of a background on how it got started. Pennsylvania has received over the years a number of what are called Transformation Transfer Initiative grants. I believe this was the 7th that Pennsylvania has received over the years. And Pennsylvania, the Office of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services, wanted to use this money and this grant to create an additional training for certified peer specialists. In the past, Pennsylvania has created trainings for certified peer specialists to specialize in forensics, in working with an older adult population, in working with veterans, and they wanted to add another training for certified peer specialists to be able to work with individuals in crisis intervention services. So the Pennsylvania Office of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services partnered with the Pennsylvania Peer Support Coalition, with Temple University, and with Allegheny and Delaware counties. The reason we partnered with Allegheny and Delaware counties is that they already had started to integrate peer support specialists into their crisis services. There were some other counties in the Commonwealth that have done that, but it's not a widely used practice yet. And one of the reasons we've added this training is we're hoping to expand that. After we got all the partners on board, we decided that the best way to proceed and to do a little bit of research in what we should include in the training was to hold some focus groups in those partner counties and speak to the people who were already doing the job. So we included in the focus groups the CPSs that were working in the services, in the crisis services, including we included supervisors and leadership, we included county staff, and we really picked their brains as to what they were doing in their counties. We wanted to get a wider idea beyond those counties as well, though, so we also created two parallel surveys that we sent out to all county leadership within the Commonwealth. And then we also sent it out. The coalition has a list of certified peer specialists that work within the state or that are not necessarily working, but, you know, CPSs that live in the state. We sent a survey out to them as well to kind of pick their brains and get an idea as to what they would envision as being necessary to be included in the training. So just a little bit of some numbers on the responses that we received. So we received 34 responses from 24 different counties within the state. That was for the first survey, the survey that was sent out to the county leadership. So some counties sent multiple responses, but there were 24 individual counties that responded. And of those, 7 reported that they were currently using peer supports in crisis services. Then the individual surveys that we sent out to the CPSs, we received 107 responses out of approximately 600 sent that represented responses from 33 different counties. And at least one individual from those 33 different counties responded that there were CPSs being used in 14 of them. Hopefully that all makes sense. But it gives you an idea. Pennsylvania has, I always forget the total number of counties. I think it's 50-something. It gives you an idea of the fact that it's not a widely spread service that's not widely being used widely yet in the Commonwealth. Results from the focus groups and both surveys were very similar in terms of roles and responsibilities needed. So there wasn't a wide range in responses. We found that the information that we gathered from the focus groups and from the surveys were all pretty close in terms of what we should include in the training. We also found that the roles and responsibilities were pretty consistent across the four defined crisis services available in Pennsylvania. And let me just mention those four defined services. So the services that the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania defines as being crisis are the telephone hotline services, the walk-in crisis services, the mobile crisis teams that go out, and then the residential services. Of those four services, the only one of those that the Commonwealth requires the counties to have is the hotline. The other three are not required, so some counties have them, some counties don't. It varies pretty widely between counties, between the counties, which of those services they offer. So based on all of the information gathered, we decided that what the training needed to be was a face-to-face training. We had asked the participants if they thought it should be online, if it should be a combination, but pretty overwhelmingly from the CPSs and from the county reps, they felt it needed to be a face-to-face training. 70.89% of CPSs and 67.86% of county reps said it really should be a face-to-face training. Even though 3 days was not the highest vote getter for the length of the training, most people felt it needed to be 5 or more days just for practicality's sake in terms of people being able to make it to a training. We decided that 3 days was going to be the maximum that we could do, especially if the participants were already working. Getting out of a job for a training that's more than 5 days long or you know, full week long is sometimes very difficult. So for practical reasons, we decided that we needed to keep it within 3 days. We also asked participants if they thought it should be half days, 1 day a week for 3 weeks, or if we should just do back-to-back days. And again, pretty overwhelmingly, especially among the certified peer specialists, they felt it needed to be back-to-back. So that's what we did. So the training ended up being a face-to-face training that lasts for 3 days and that they're back-to-back days, full days. And then we took all of the information of what the participants felt needed to be included in the training and created 5 modules that we would offer over that 3 days. The first module we called Crisis 101. It's just the basics. It includes information on the Pennsylvania Mental Health Procedure Act, just real basic information on that. We really focused mostly on defining crisis in this particular model so that we can make sure that we're all on the same page. A lot of people tend to combine crisis and emergency services in their mind, and we wanted to make it clear up front that we're talking about crises and not emergencies, which are different. Emergency services are a step higher, a higher level of service from crisis services. But we do obviously make the point that the two services work very closely together. Then we created what we called the professional development module. That's the module where we focus on what the roles and responsibilities of a certified peer specialist are within crisis services, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in just a few minutes. There was among the participants, they felt really strongly that we needed to focus a lot on communication and having effective communication skills and using communication as an intervention tool. And under communication, we have a number of subtopics, including working on building strong relationships, focusing on boundaries, one of the things with crisis services, and this was emphasized by the participants in the focus groups, is that a lot of the skills that certified peer specialists use in other services, it's still the same skills that you would use in crisis services. It's just a more intense setting. So one of the things that we talk about in the training is how to build relationships, how to maintain boundaries, how to use self-disclosure, how to use, I heard, I believe Jim mentioned motivational interviewing earlier, how to use all those skills that you would use in as a CPS in other settings, but how to use them in the intense setting of crisis services, that it's, while it's the same skill, the setting is really unique from some of the other services that CPSs are being used in currently. And then we also talk a lot about de-escalation skills as part of communication. The number one identified topic that we needed to include in this training was the suicide assessment and prevention module. So that's tackled on the first part of day three. And then the very last thing that we talk about is self-care. Again, self-care is covered a lot in other trainings, but it was emphasized in both the surveys, but particularly the focus groups, that because of the intense nature of crisis services, it needed to be addressed again. Now, see, I talked about all that without my slides. So, the one thing with self-care, one of the other things, one of the things that are, that we include in that, I didn't mention this, that we really talk about the differences between compassion fatigue, burnout, vicarious trauma, because at least I felt being able to identify the differences between the three of those and knowing which of those you may be affected by is going to help you with how you implement your self-care strategies. So that is included in the self-care module. So after we created the training, after all of the partners worked together to create those five modules and get them to a point where we felt they were in a good place, we went ahead and held two pilot trainings in March of 2016. The first pilot training was from March 1st to the 3rd, and it was held in Delaware County, and we had 28 participants. And then a few weeks later, we held a second pilot training from March 22nd to 24th in Allegheny County with 25% participants. The feedback for the trainings was pretty positive. There weren't a whole lot of changes that participants requested. They felt that what we had was good material, so we only had to make some minor revisions. So I just wanted to take a minute here to go through what the identified roles and responsibilities were for certified peer specialists working in crisis services. And again, they're not necessarily a whole lot different from other services. It's just the setting that really makes the difference and warrants having this training and warrants taking time talking about them. One of the first responsibilities or roles that a certified peer specialist can play in the various crisis services is initial engagement, using a certified peer specialist right up front as the first contact with an individual. Whether that be answering the phones at a hotline, doing the intake at a residential or a walk-in service, being part of the mobile crisis team. I should mention with our two partner counties, Allegheny County tended to use their certified peer specialists in their residential service and a little bit on their hotline. And then out in Delaware, they were using their CPSs more on the mobile crisis teams. Obviously, providing peer support, using one's lived experience, using self-disclosure skills, assisting people using an already developed wrap. We've talked about wrap in terms of using it, developing it, if you're doing wrap groups at like residential settings or, you know, facilitating groups, which I'll talk about in a second, as well as being a role that peer supports fulfill. But of course, helping develop a vision beyond the post or beyond the crisis situation that the individual's in. Assessment, I always have to be careful with this one. We're not talking about clinical assessments, but CPSs can certainly offer a different perspective from other professionals that might be working with the individual. One of the participants in Allegheny was talking about a situation where she was working with some of her coworkers, and they were I don't want to say blaming, but they were assigning certain behaviors or symptoms that an individual was exhibiting to the mental health diagnosis that individual had. And she, as the CPS, was like, well, wait, let's take a step back and look at circumstances. Like, maybe she's responding this way, you know, because of other things that are going on. It doesn't necessarily have to be the mental health diagnosis that is causing her to react the way that she's reacting. Maybe this is just a normal reaction to the to whatever is going on in her life right now. So a lot of times certified peer specialists can offer that different kind of perspective in different situations. Certainly using de-escalation skills and acting as an agent of de-escalation is a big role or responsibility that CPSs have in crisis services. I mentioned being a running groups is something that CPSs can do in crisis services. Working on life skills, activities, anything that can help them transition back into the community beyond the crisis. Acting as a support to families, one of the things we talk a lot about is the fact that a certified peer specialist can offer the same kind of hope for the future to families who have often lost hope as well. So using the same kind of self-disclosure skills and using their own story to provide hope and inspire hope within the families is just as important as using that as a tool for the individuals as well. Someone mentioned, I think it was Jim, mentioned being a resource broker. A lot of times CPSs know more of what's available or know resources that are available that other professionals aren't necessarily aware of. So certainly acting as a resource broker and being there to be able to offer insight into the services and other resources that are out there is paramount. Helping with discharge planning. And this was a big one, acting as a follow-up agent after the crisis has passed, making sure individuals are able to connect with the resources or any other referrals that have been made, any appointments that have been made, and just checking in and making sure that everything's going okay to try to avoid any recurrence of the crisis. And then finally, obviously, you can't get away from documentation. Even in crisis services. So the future of this training is that we're hoping to be able to roll this out to the rest of the Commonwealth. It's actually exciting. The reason I'm not there today is that I'm, as I said, I'm in Montgomery County. We're running the very first non-pilot training here. And we're in our third day today. I took a step out. I have a co-trainer, so she's in there doing the training while I came over into a separate classroom to participate. So again, I'm sorry I'm not there, but this was a really exciting opportunity for the coalition to be able to run this training, again, as a non-pilot, as just the training itself. It's really exciting to be here. We're actually going to be holding a webinar for county leaders on September 8th to try to spread the word that this training is developed and it's ready to go, and we are ready to bring it to other parts of Pennsylvania and potentially beyond. One of the reasons that we're here participating as part of the INAPS conference is hoping to talk to people who are beyond Pennsylvania, outside of our Commonwealth, and say that hey, we have this training developed. While there are some parts of it that are Pennsylvania-specific, we can certainly make adjustments to it. And if it's something that other states are interested in, they don't necessarily need to reinvent the wheel. We might be able to help them out with that. So hopefully, spreading the word and getting the word out there that we have created this training is part of what we're doing right now, and hopefully we'll be able to get it out there, certainly within Pennsylvania and perhaps even beyond. So here's how you get a hold of the coalition. If you're interested in talking to us more about this training and this opportunity, you can contact us at info@papsc.org. I think I have a few minutes, so I'm going to rely on my friends there, Jim and Rick. If anyone has questions or comments or anything, I'll be happy to answer. So, floor is open.
Can you hear us, Jim?
Yes, I can.
Okay, Jim, you had a comment?
Rick, Jim, good to hear you. Great job. I want to tell you that Crisis Mobile Team, Delaware County, just spoke to the supervisor not too long ago. You probably met Will, who's our CPS on that team.
Yeah, he was at our pilot.
Yep. Here's the word. They don't know how they did it without him. He was their first point of contact, helped to de-escalate, and that's the professional clinical staff saying, we don't know how we did it without the CPS.
Yeah, I really feel that this is a real important expansion of certified peer specialist services into this particular area. Will is a great guy. He helped a lot. He was part of our focus groups. He came to the pilot, and yeah, it's great to hear that he's appreciated in Delaware.
Dave, I also wanted to mention that there are some resources that developed out of this program. David has both a wonderful trainees manual with all the forms and exercises that are part of the training. But he's also developed a trainer's manual that helps people figure out how to use the model that they've developed. And both are things that you can talk to Dave and the coalition about directly. As part of the training, we also developed here at Temple a 15-minute video. Initially, what we were asked to do is create some short interviews, record some short interviews with people who are currently working as peer specialists within crisis services. What was the nature of their jobs? What did they like about their jobs? What were the stresses and strains? What were the satisfactions? Where did they keep themselves going? How did they get along with other people on the team? And they've used that to sort of generate discussion as they move through this 3-day sequence. We have since put that together as a 15-minute video that's available on our website as well as from Dave that you can use to sort of introduce the topic of what it's like to be a peer specialist working within crisis service. And you'll see on the materials you've got how you can access that from our pucollaborative.org website. Are there other questions or observations there?
Hi,
the question
I have is, how does this help peer specialists who are working in mobile services?
Can you hear Dave?
We have all peer programs, and all they do is the mobile services, and they're already doing a lot of this stuff, and how can this help them even more in the jobs that they're doing?
Did you hear that, Dave?
I caught some of it. Could you help me out?
Project my voice a little?
Yeah.
My question is, how can this help our peer specialists that are currently already working with crisis programs?
Um, That's a good question. I would hope that that people or CPSs that are already working in crisis services could still get some useful information out of it. Now, we were asked in the development phase of this training to try not to overlap other information that that any staff working in a crisis service might receive as part of the on-the-job training, to try to focus the information we presented as being very specific to the issues that a certified peer specialist would need to meet. It is basic information to prepare them. It was really designed for CPSs who are not working in crisis yet, who want to move in that direction. That being said, almost all of the CPSs that were in the pilots were already working in crisis services, and a handful of the CPSs that are here at the Montgomery County training that we're doing right now are currently working in crisis services. And I feel that there is still information in here that, that could benefit individuals who are already in the service. If at the very least, if not necessarily new information, reinforcing skills and responsibilities and knowledge that they may already have. I hope that makes sense.
I'm thinking that it also gives people an opportunity to talk about their roles as peer specialists and other peer specialists who are in similar roles, to share information and resources and reinforce one another's best tendencies and perhaps challenge one another in perhaps less successful practice.
Yeah, at the end of each day, we do an exercise where we go around the room and each person finishes a sentence of today I liked, today I learned, today I appreciated, and they can, you know, finish any of those sentences. And yesterday, one of the women who is one of them who currently works in crisis services, what she said was, today I appreciated finding out that what I'm doing is correct. So that was kind of nice to hear. She said that sometimes she's not real sure of what she's doing, and that this training, at least what we discussed yesterday, really helped reinforce her knowledge and her confidence in what she is doing currently.
Jim, you wanted to ask a question?
Well, I think this may be part of the question here. One of the things that we do in Delaware County, yesterday actually, we have a monthly peer support learning community. So we get our CPSs in for a couple of hours every month to share, and Will's often there, right, to share what's going on with him and other folks that are working, and some folks that aren't working, get to hear what each other is doing and to support one another.
Other questions for David about the crisis intervention stuff?
Hi, how are you? My question is, as being a certified peer specialist, and I know we're supposed to have a warm line, because we know at any time one of our members can go in crisis at any time, should each peer specialist be assigned a warm line phone, or should it be one to pass around in the organization?
That broke up a little bit, so I only caught half of what she asked.
It relates to the question of a warm line phone, and should there be one for the whole organization or several of them?
For the crisis to be prevented instead of
the crisis prevention.
Well,
you know, I don't know. It's a good acceptable answer.
Yeah. I'm not sure. I guess one of the things I would like to say is, in distinction, warm lines are not, at least in Pennsylvania, just to make this distinction, warm lines are not technically considered one of the crisis services. That doesn't mean that people don't call warm lines with you know, who are in crises, which is why we allow pretty much anyone to take the training. because we figured anyone could benefit. But does your warm line currently only have one phone? Is that why you're asking?
Yes, we have about six of us in the whole building, and it's one phone. And apparently, the phone line, whoever had it, has not been being answered. So we've been having members in crisis, which I think that is unfair to the member because we are here to support and be there for them.
Yeah, that sounds like a limitation, and that might be a funding issue. I'm not sure. I think ideally you would certainly have more than one line so that if you're talking to someone and there's someone else who calls in, you can still take that call.
David, let me ask you another question because you mentioned
Hey, Rick, I just want to interject real quick. We do have some questions from our online audience. I want to make sure we get to those too, but I don't want to interrupt at a bad time and get through all the questions in the workshop first. So just let me know when it'd be a good time to bring up some questions from the online audience.
Okay. Well, I'll go with mine first because I'm in charge. you mentioned the importance of follow-up. And I'm wondering if you got much feedback from the people you've been in training with regards to the importance, the role that they play in helping people stay connected to what they were involved with in their community life otherwise.
I'm sorry, say that again.
Yeah, I'm wondering in the follow-up function whether you're getting any feedback that people are involved in that and involved in helping people stay connected to community life.
No, not a whole lot of feedback yet. But again, I imagine that as we do more trainings and have more people involved in working in crisis services, we'll learn more about that.
All right, then let's go to the phones for questions that are coming in online.
All righty, Rick. So I have a couple questions from Elaine Wilson. And her first question was, is welcoming community, the definition of a welcoming community, would that be in the person's own community or would that be in the community at large? And Elaine said often the larger community tends to reject some recovery groups because they lack social skills, certain dress codes, et cetera. So she wants to know, is welcoming communities, what community specifically would that refer to?
Okay, I think that, I just want to be clear, that seems to be a more generic question based on the whole framework of the training, and that's particularly directed to David and his discussion. David, maybe we'll take that. You're welcome to stay online with us, but if you need, we did beg you for just half an hour, and you've more than adequately met your obligation. So stay on if you like, and I'll try to answer that question.
Just real quick, I do need to get back to my training here. So real quick, thank you for letting me be a part of this through this, since I couldn't make it there. If anyone has any questions for me about the Pennsylvania Peer Support Coalition or the training, certainly feel free to send emails to that email address. I'm the one who checks that, so I will be happy to answer any questions that way. So thank you again, and I have to get back.
Thank you very much.
Take care, everyone.
Let's get back to the question of welcoming communities. I think the question broadly, I realize I'm shouting a lot, but community behavior, directly through volume in Montgomery County. I think the question about welcoming communities really it depends on what the individual is interested in. We think of going about it in a very person-by-person fashion. So if one individual wants to join a baseball league at a local public recreational program, then what we're looking for is to be able to work with that recreational program to make them aware of that there's a person who would like to join who may need support and a special welcome. Now, if it's if someone who wants to join a congregation, if it's someone who wants to join a sewing club, if it's someone who wants to get into a GED educational program or a community college training program, that's the community we're talking about. One of the things I think we're learning about working and education in the community is that large-scale public education programs don't work terribly well, but individual connections between people tend to be what works. And so I think we want to go about the notion of welcoming the community by asking the individuals we're serving, what community do you want to connect to, and how can we help you connect to that particular community? And therein, we get back to the issue that somebody raised earlier about disclosure. In each of these instances, the individual you're working with should certainly have the choice of getting your support, whether they want to disclose or they don't. So if somebody wants to disclose, you can say to them, would you like me to approach the minister in this church? Would you like me to approach the head of the sports program at the Y? Would you like me to talk to the admissions officer at the vocational training program you want to get into and to request support, and I can be part of that? Somebody was using the example of the person from the Y wanted the peer specialist there. And all of that is fine. If you said to the individual in question, are you comfortable with the notion of disclosure? And if you've taken the time to talk about the how to do disclosure, there are all kinds of issues that emerge. Who do you disclose to? How much do you disclose? When do you disclose? There are going to be a lot of people who say, no, I don't want, I didn't want to join the congregation. I don't want a spotlight on me as a person with mental illness. I just want to play second base. I don't want to be a crazy person playing second base. I just want to be involved. I just want to get a job. I don't want to be identified. That doesn't mean the peer specialist withdraws. It means the peer specialist helps that person figure out how to manage to join that community activity without disclosure, and then has an ongoing dialogue with them over the months or years about, do you want to disclose now? Who would you disclose to? Or would you just assume not? There's nothing more important than leaving that discussion and that decision to the individual involved. When we survey people about employment, almost everybody we survey who was a person with a mental illness said, if you don't have to disclose at work, don't. If you're not comfortable with that, then you should and figure out a way to do it. If you're going to require reasonable accommodations, you'll have to disclose. But, geez, if you don't have to, don't. I'm not sure how that applies in other situations, but it clearly is a decision that individuals make and that we live with as mental health systems, and where we provide support either way to the individual, whatever they want to do. Rich,
I was just wondering, because what I've done is build a coaching model that helps people learn about disclosure. And because of recent changes in government regulations regarding government contractors, has been looking at how to use changes in Section 503 and endeavor. Let me just mention that certainly it's a game changer. Conferences, and certainly it's a game changer. What happened in January 2014 was there were some new regulations that got into place, executive order. And if a company is a government contractor or a subcontractor, and they have $50,000 worth of government business, and we could keep employees a little bit more technical, we'll just set up the guidelines, that company is now required to have 7% of their workforce people with disabilities. And that's kind of a big game changer. So I've been on the BLN, Disability Leadership Network in Pennsylvania, that gets some conference. I love that. I'm looking for it. So the thing is, what is important is that for people who have an invisible disability, I call it privilege. Q-IWIDS. Qualified individuals with invisible disabilities. They're now in demand in certain companies. But if and my word is comfort. So if I've got a comfort candidate who knows their rights and responsibilities under the ADA and how to disclose properly, then it's a matter of finding a company with the proper company culture. It could be a small business where they just get it, you know, standing on business where a lot of jobs are created. Or it could be a corporation that has a disability diversity initiative and absolutely has all the support in place because it's supported employment that works. Natural support in the workplace is what we want to have, and people can create a space within the employment realm where they are comfortable because they've been able to be empowered by us to know how to do it, and that's.
But it remains a matter of personal choice. There's no situation which is required to reveal or to reveal after a certain time or either before the job or after the job. It really is, unless you're requesting reasonable accommodations under the ADA, it remains your choice. I'm wondering if we can think some other questions that have come in electronically.
Hey, Rick, I do have just one more question at this time.
Maybe not. So let's turn to the group. Adam, we'll come to you.
I'm thinking about public advocacy. William White has an analogy that he uses about instead of just treating the tree is that you treat the soil. So preparing our communities to be welcome to communities requires a certain amount of disability. How do you balance that need to make the community more aware? I remember what you said about individual connections working better than large scale educational efforts, but you know, if you look at the recovery walk, very visible public.
Tell me your story, what you're interested in, and let me try to figure out how I can help you. And that's the importance of the training that Jim is doing, but it applies to all these other domains. Of what are people really interested in. Rick.
Yeah, I have a question. It's certainly not so much, and the peer specialist model really seems to be that hands-on, face-to-face policy, which is so important. But we've got a brand new world, and I actually get all these the stories to read through sites called the Mighty. And so this is where people who have mental illness, and they just tell the stories. Now, certainly with Adam saying about advocacy and getting the word out there to these people, I think it's important, but how do you see peer specialists online? Where does that go?
Well, I think individual peer specialists have the same choices to make. I mean, obviously they've self-disclosed in order, as Jim says, to get the job. That doesn't mean when they go to church. It doesn't mean when they go to a recreational program or a movie in the park or start a romantic relationship with somebody they've met, that they have to do the same disclosure. People have to make very difficult and individual decisions. Clearly, the braver people are about doing that and the more skilled they are about doing that, the better off we'll be, but it's a creeping kind of public education process. I think we're involved in.
I'm not even worrying about as much the individual care specialist disclosing online in their support, but how can the model of peer-to-peer support go from a face-to-face to an online model? Is that something that's ever possible?
Yeah, I think there are places that already do that. In crisis intervention, for instance, there's a lot of folks have been talking about online crisis and conversations. And in fact, the internet is what they're realizing is they need to be tweeting because that's where the kids are. And they're more comfortable talking about themselves in that environment than in personal counseling. You had a question, Dana, answer. Okay, no, we'll get to that. Okay, Dana.
I'm going to say something controversial.
Uh-oh!
Oh, good. Let me turn my chair around. I like
this. You talked about how people actually have a choice when they disclose or when they don't disclose. And I'm of the opinion that the title of peer specialist is actually a problem because it robs the person of their exposure of who they come when. So if it's on a resume, they now have to explain to the rest of the life what is a peer specialist. So in Florida, we've really been moving towards job titles that are much more specific to the role that they're actually doing because we're seeing people coming into the field number and don't want to respect the fact they do not want to self-identify the person in their life.
All right, Dana.
Hey, that's a good point. I mean, but I think, again, how you fill out your job application and what you do with your resume is another one of those individual decisions.
Yes, but I had a talk to someone who was in a hospital and had a concussion, and they were talking about how they were doing fine, and they were there, and so one time her bell just went, oh, you're the peer specialist, and the staff hadn't left the room yet. And the next time, I wasn't allowed in when we had a scheduled visit. So and then when they knew I was here, especially, they probably looked at my record and thought, I've been in here.
I don't want to be Pollyannish about the issue of disclosure. There are real problems involved with disclosure, which is why it's so much more important for people to do it when they have the strength and feel that they can do it and fight through the problems.
So they, like on certain peer specialist application, they'll ask you, are you living with a current disability or whatever. And then I noticed if you check no, you won't get hired. They won't even call you for an interview or nothing. They'll just send an automatic open receipt or resume.
You mean if you
meet our criteria,
right?
Then someone will call you.
You're saying if you say you don't have a disability or if you do?
Yeah. Right. Maybe you're absent, living with a disability, have a disability, something, or I don't have a disability.
See, the criteria for certified
peer
specialist is definitely somebody that has been able to do something and came out of our system.
Right.
Now you're basically a new creation and you're working in the field helping people that have challenges just like you used to have challenges. So we shouldn't be discriminated upon. However, thinking outside the box, when I go to prison, I don't tell them I'm a peer specialist. I tell them I'm a case manager and I have to get in. So they can put me in their system and I do that because we're a team. We work together as a team in my job. And the recovery coach is the one that usually goes to the prison. But if she's not there to do that, I have to step in. That's what a team player is.
It's an interesting.
And that's thinking outside of the box. You know, because regardless of who you are, you're there to provide a service. And that's what I do.
But it is an interesting area for some research, I think, in terms of the degree to which peer specialists experience a prejudice. We have a good sense that a lot of peer specialists experience it even within their own agency. But you're talking even in the broader human services field. Ma'am?
Yeah, another thing they want with respect to labeling PTSD. I'm in the field for 15 years working as a mental illness specialist. And when I have my languages, different agencies, whatever, they're like, oh, my bunch of teammates, like, they kind of look at you as like, show me the rest of the language, whatever, like, right, or they don't know what you're. So sometimes what I might do is not say I'm a teacher, say, well, I'm a mental illness specialist, so I'm a mental illness specialist. And then as we get into it, I'll say, oh, by the way, I am a CPS. And they kind of have a hug, another look like,
And, you know, I guess that's the kind of discrimination that PTSD get, like, they look at us like, well, they just said this, and they really don't know this as well. Whereas the peer that we're working with loves that we're there and loves that we're, you know, helping themselves evolve and keep the community and like this.
So part of the challenge in the future is not only expanding the role, but grappling with both subtle and overt prejudice that peer specialists see directed toward them.
But another So we get, you know, some of us have more support with the peer or the participant. Yeah.
It was very clear when we did the interviews for Dave's crisis intervention program that the peer specialists felt as though they were, I don't know, another fresh air, a breath of fresh air, that people were just thrilled to have someone they instinctively felt had a better grasp on what the experience was actually like. Rick?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, my story is that I did not get an OVR, so I didn't get that support. But I've been working, and I have spent a decade working very hard on my recovery, divorce, and all this other stuff. So I can just tell you, coming back professional, I have to make, and I'm still making every day, very, very serious decisions about disclosure. And I lost everything about me is only on my LinkedIn profile. And I came up with a word because I didn't know what to call myself. I'm a qualified individual with invisible disability. But the only thing that really can tell from my LinkedIn profile is that I walked in, not this year, the last year, I walked in the Navi walk and supported it. But I tried to stay a little slow, but people who know me, I still have OCD, so. And then I talk to other people and say, oh, yeah, well, so the younger people, no problem. Because they grew up with the idea, said before, I didn't go to school with other people with disabilities. But now in work cases, I get it, because schools are doing pretty well. And it's just, look, I've been doing this for a while, and I know that integration is not easy, and job development, my field is not easy, but also it's a very individual decision. Every person has to make based on their level of recovery and the supports that they need. And, you know, thank God. I applied.
And it's not a one-time decision. It can be a decision. This is what I'm comfortable with now. Check back with me in 6 months or a year or 5 years. I may want to make another decision then.
A couple of things. At the CPS here, as you just stated, and I recognize you have the CPS meeting, in order to be a CPS and get into that training, the first question is, do you have a mental health disability?
Yeah.
You have to be diagnosed. Okay. So if you're applying for a CPS position, and on that application you say, no, you don't have a disability, you lost. And that's a given. In Philadelphia, they've changed this in some different ways.
Let me ask a process question. I'm sorry, because we said this was going to be 9 to 12. People want to continue to stay for a few more minutes and discuss, or should we bring it to a close? A resource, okay.
Answer about peer support online. There is a service called Peer Solutions, and it is a web community where you can have groups online to actually see you online, the correlate group online. Peer Solutions. It's not a free service, but it's just something you can look into. And what's good about that is other organizations from anywhere around the world can log on and participate in your booth.
All right.
So,
thank you.
You're welcome.
Let me just say, I think we're going to end because people are looking antsy and half of you have left. Please be in touch with us, give us your feedback, but also let us know if we can be helpful with you guys in terms of talking about how to expand the roles of peer specialists where you are, both in these ways we've discussed today and in any other ways that you think would be helpful. Thank you all very much for coming.